Is it seen by everyone, this one?
Yes, sir.
Okay, let us proceed. What was that last session we have seen? Anyone remembering the last session? Anyone remembering the last session?
We did loops, sir.
Okay. Yeah, loops we have covered. So next, today we'll go to this one. Tasks and functions. Then we'll come back to loops again. So because we are rushing to wrap our session today possibly or tomorrow. So that's why we'll visit again loops. So meanwhile, so this tasks and functions, before going to the tasks and functions, so everybody might be knowing this one, you have this one. So suppose say you are adding two numbers. So add A, B. So somewhere down the line in your code, again you may be in need of add C, D. Again down the line somewhere you may be in need of add some X, Y. So several times here this piece of code is required to just to perform this addition operation here. And the same piece of code even required here to put again just to perform this one. Again, the same piece of code is required just to perform this add operation here. So instead putting several times wherever required such operation, this piece of code, what we do is, we put somewhere else. We give some name. So let us say this is the add itself. And wherever required this one, we don't write any piece of code there. Simply, we call that add here. That's it. So here required, then use that add here. So let us say this is add two, and the name here is add two. And this also you use, add two. So now, what is that? This piece of code? This piece of code is a procedure. Is a procedure. Procedures. In a high-level language, we say procedures, C, C++, or any other high-level language. So these procedures are like a function call. It's a function. Functions. So here in this Verilog HDL, such functions, such procedures, we have two types. One is a task, the other is a function itself. The other is a function itself. So that's what we are going to learn today, your tasks and functions. So in this tasks and functions, let us just quickly rush through this learning objectives here. Describe the difference between tasks and functions. That is one. Identify the conditions required for tasks to be defined. Understand task declaration and invocation. Invocation, nothing but calling. Explain the conditions necessary for functions to be defined. Understand function declaration and invocation. So, when is required a function to be declared and called? And when is required task to be declared and to use it and to invoke it? Invocation. So, that thing is a learning objective. So this is again the same initially what I just I was explaining in the paint, saying that a designer is frequently required to implement the same functionality at many times. So designer frequently required to implement the same functionality at many places. So this means that commonly used parts should should be abstracted into routines, procedures. I was using the procedures, so these are routines. And the routines must be invoked instead of repeating the code. Instead of repeating the code, these procedures needs to be invoked. Most programming languages provide procedures. So this is called procedures in most other languages. Or subroutines to accomplish this, that is the same. Verilog provides tasks and functions to break up large behavioral designs into smaller pieces. So in the Verilog language, in other languages, what we have, these procedures, in the Verilog HDL, we have this tasks and functions. Tasks and functions allow designer to abstract Verilog code that is used at many places in the design. Tasks have input, we'll see the differences shortly, output, and in-out arguments. So this input shouldn't be taken in the sense this is your top module. This is your top module. This top module may have primary inputs and primary outputs. These primary inputs and primary outputs we use with a keyword called input. And we use a keyword called output. And if there is an in-out, then that is in-out keyword. Keyword is used. They are the ports of the top module. And the keywords are used here, input, output, in-out. So the guys there, this is just a moment. Where I was. So here, never ever mix up the task keywords. Those are this input, what we are using here, input, output, and in-out. The in-out. These keywords that are used in the task are totally local to this task. These keywords are totally local to the task. And the keywords that we use in the design file, top module, we may have primary inputs and primary outputs. These are ports. These are ports. These are ports. And the keyword that you use for the ports again are still same. This very keywords you use. Especially new learner, he or she should not have any confusion. Again, I'm repeating the keywords input, output, in-out. These keywords you see in the top module. Top module means anything that is you are designing, for example, half adder or full adder, you are designing, suppose. So if you are designing any component, this component will have some primary inputs and primary outputs. So at that time, what we call them technically ports. These components will have ports. So these ports are defined in the Verilog language with the keyword input, with the keyword output, with the keyword in-out. And very same keywords are used in the task to send the arguments. What are the arguments, what we mean by arguments, and we will see shortly. Just to send something to the task and to obtain from the task something, we use this input, output, in-outs. So these are not ports here. These are, in this context, these keywords are not representing the ports. We use input, output, in-out keywords in the task. These keywords are not representing ports if you use them in the task. We use these keywords in your component at the port level, at the declaration level. They are ports. They are treated as ports. So that should be clear to the especially new learner. Coming to this point here. And this one, functions have input arguments. They have only input arguments. Thus, values can be passed into and out from the task and functions. With the help of this this one, we may send some arguments to the function, and we may take from some arguments from the task and function with the help of this. Tasks and functions are included in the design hierarchy like named blocks. Tasks or functions can be addressed by means of hierarchical names that we will see shortly. Here, this PPT I will share anyway with you people. You can go through this same so far what we have discussed, just tabulated here. Function can enable another function, but not another task. This hasn't come there, but not another task. Remember, a function can enable another function, but not another task. A task can enable other tasks and functions. Being in the one task, you can call another task or another function. But being in function, you only can call a function, but not another task. Functions always execute in zero simulation time. This is another point that we have to observe. Tasks may execute in non-zero simulation time, meaning these delays, this pound symbol, delay control operator. This delay control operator usage is allowed in the task. Inside the task, we can use this. But here in the function, we cannot use. Why and all, we'll see elaboratively later on. Functions must not contain any delay, event, or timing control. The same here. This task may contain delay, event, and timing control. You know this event, timing control, and all. This at symbol usage. This is also allowed here, apart from this pound here. And functions must have at least one input argument. They can have more than one input. This is again the one important point here. This is important. This is also important. In zero simulation time, it will execute like you have seen their initial. You have seen initial and always. The difference we have seen. When you run the simulation is suppose say here. You have simulation is starting from zero and proceeding here. Still some time unit here, let us say that is n. We don't know what n is. So maybe 100. Again, the physical time we don't know, nanosecond or picosecond or microsecond. So let us say n time unit. That's why n time unit. It starts from zero and it moves. So what happens is in the always, whenever there is an event occurring here, in this event sensitivity list in the always, then this block is triggered, and whatever single statement or multiple statements, those are executed. But in the initial case, what happens, we have seen in earlier slides, earlier sessions, at zero simulation time, it will be executed. When simulation is proceeding, this block is not executed again and again. That is the meaning of zero simulation time. Guys, there, especially new learner, I am focusing. Zero simulation time means it must be clear to you. And task may execute in non-zero simulation time. Non-zero simulation time means not only here execution, and if required, because depending upon the sensitivity list here, whenever this is triggered and this is executed at any point of time during the simulation, at any point of time, this always block is triggered. Similar to this initial and always explanation, just now what we recollected, though it has been covered earlier. And the same logic is applied to this function and the task. Is that clear to especially new learner what I'm trying to focus here? If otherwise, there is no meaning if you are attending. Is that clear what I am trying to?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So if you have any queries, kindly unmute and speak. So just let me clear everything. Okay. So that is what this zero simulation time means. And delay and all, this usage of this pound and at, and there is an event keyword itself. So such is not allowed here. Such is not allowed in the function. and such are allowed in the task. That is the thing here that we have to understand. Earlier, I kept here the found, right? It's not about the found. This point is talking about. This point is talking about. The found, found comes here. This is execution, about the execution. Execution, just now I said initial and always. Analogy I gave. The same analogy applies to function and task. Hopefully this is clear. If someone is still having doubt, they can unmute and ask. So let us proceed here. Functions must have at least one input argument. This is again an important point. Without any, at least one input argument, you cannot have a function. So tasks may have zero also. This is again the important observation that we have to make. It can have zero without any argument. Passage of any argument is not required. Functions always return a single value. They cannot have output and in-out arguments. They will not be having in-out arguments. In-out or output arguments. They return only single value. Tasks do not return with a value, but can pass multiple values through output in-out arguments. That we'll see with example. This point we'll see with example. If I say anything theoretically, then it is best. So further differences. Apart from these differences, this table has got totally different differences. So you have to go through this and this as well. And this as well. This is again different. Both tasks and functions must be defined in a module and are local to the module. This is again one point. So both tasks and functions must be defined in a module and are local to that module only. Tasks are used for common Verilog code that contains delays, timing. This has come earlier. Here it has come. No need to explain this one again. Functions are used when common Verilog code purely combinational, executes in zero simulation time, and provides exactly one output. This is something important here. Purely combinational here. You see this one. Purely combinational. Now question rises here, can't we use for any sort of sequential applications? Your counter is there, registers are there, your FSM in case of FSM are partly combinational and partly sequential circuits. So this is a combination sequence that we'll see shortly. So point here is, this is the point. In which sense we are speaking? That is the point that we have to ask ourselves. Functions are used when common Verilog code is purely combination. Executing zero simulation. This zero simulation time anyway we covered here. But the point, new point here to focus is purely combinational behavior. Then only functions are allowed. So functions are typically used for conversions. And commonly used, anyway, these applications point of view we are talking about. So only the point here to focus is this one, purely combination. We'll see with example. So functions can have input arguments, this we have seen. Tasks or functions cannot have while. This is another important point, because this one we have seen already. The point here is while they cannot have. This is the important one. Inside, we cannot have while. Everything is reg. Tasks and functions contain behavioral statements only. This is again another important, behavioral statements only. At this stage, we should be knowing what is meant by behavioral statement, because several times we spoke, always and initial, anything that comes here is a behavioral statement, is a procedural statement, because these are the behavioral constructs, no? This always and this initial, these are called structured procedures. Are procedural constructs or behavioral level constructs. Inside behavioral level construct, always initial, whatever that we use here statement is a procedural statement, is a behavioral level statement. So same statements are allowed inside the task and function. Not that assign you use that, in data flow level modeling, that is not allowed. Or something you use AND gate and the keyword, that is not allowed. This is the gate level modeling. Such constructs are not allowed inside the task and function. Only behavioral statements are allowed. What is meant by behavioral statement? That we know already. So we'll see with example that. If you still have any problem, we'll see with example. Just a moment. So transient functions don't contain always or initial. This is always an initial statement inside the task inside the function. It will not come inside the task, inside the function. Can I have always means no. Can I have initial means no. You invoke inside initial, inside always, task name you invoke. Inside always or inside initial, you can invoke the task or function. But inside the function, you cannot have always or you cannot have initial. Inside the function or task. This is the another point that we have to understand. So let us proceed with the example now. Very, very important point, this one. Re-entrant tasks. This is, if you see where I am here. For these functions. And re-entrant tasks, guys, this is very important. This is update in the language. Several times we spoke in 1995, some updates we have seen. In 2001, we have seen some updates. In 2005, some updates. Later on in 2010 or 12, total updates within, so we totally renamed it as a system variable. Till this point, we were calling it as a verilog only. So in 1995, it was not there, this re-entrant or automatic task. This was not there here. This has come here. So what is that re-entrant task is? Let us study. So before we go there, just a moment. Before we go to that, okay. So when we allocate some space to A and B, these variables, so in the task, there are two variables A, B, and the space allocated for them, A, B, you are invoking somewhere, let us say, just task one. One time you are invoking. Let us say you are passing some X1, Y1. And another time you are invoking, let us say, task two, X2, Y2. Now, the possibilities are there that the space allocated for this A, B, there is a space allocated, let us say, for A, 0 to 2, just for understanding, rough understanding I am giving. Then we go to the concept there, 3 to 4. This is the space for A. And this is the space for B. In this task, that is how the system compiler is allocating. Compiler job is to look after this. Now what you are doing is you are using one time here and the other time here, thinking that you will accomplish some functionality, whatever. Suppose say you are doing, suppose A plus B, possibly you think that this happens here. But what is the problem is, the space allocated now is fixed with these tasks. So this X1, the you may be sending 2, 3, and you may be sending here 4, 5. But this space is either fixed for 2 or either fixed for 4. You cannot have two dynamically allocated spaces here. Static, that is, static fixed for that space is fixed, meaning once you call the first time, the two, that is for because you are sending for the A, and three you are sending for the B, that is fixed for that. The second time when you are invoking, parallelly if you are invoking, then this is it mess up everything, that compiler. So this is already two is there. Inside, it may still continue with the 2 or it may override with the 4, and the same thing may happen here. It may still continue with the 3 or it may mess up with the 5. Now the values that needs to be sent to this invoke should be phi, but instead phi you will get something else, which is incorrect. Here it should be 9. You will, instead of getting 9, you will get something else. So this is the problem. If we earlier, so that's the point here. Re-entrant people, their language in the compiler, they made some changes, and they come up with a task called automatic. So in this automatic, somewhere I think example I have taken. I'll take that. Don't update this one. Is that clear, this concept, what I'm trying to make you people understand? Is that clear? Are you there?
Yeah, it's clear, sir.
Okay. If anyone having trouble in understanding this, you can unmute and ask one more time, I can explain. Now, what happens is with the re-entrant, let me clear this. Now, if I use automatic task, and then if I put a automatic keyword, and I continue writing the whatever the piece of code, and then end task, if I do is end task, and the same y equal to same example, if you take a plus b. Now compiler is smart enough, it has become smart enough with the addition of this automatic. It has become smart enough that it dynamically it allocates for A some space, let us say A 0 to 3, B some space 4 to 5. So two tasks again, your x1, y1. And when the other time when you parallelly, if you are performing these two tasks invocation, parallel if you're doing, then there will not be an issue because of this automatic. What it does is for this section, separate space with the A, again one more A, this is space is different. That is already done space is 0 to 3 done, 4 to 5 here done, meaning possibly let us say just understanding purpose. Here how many? 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, right? Here 6, 7, 8, 9. So four spaces for that, and this one 4, 5, no, only one space. So possibly 10 to 11. So that way it allocate. Now this can happily may go here, and this one possibly may go here, and whatever the intended task is performed here plus, and here also it is performed plus, and this task particularly, this will return that whatever that needs to be returned here, and it will return whatever needs to be returned to here. Now everything, many a times if you invoke also, no issue, because this automatic is doing the math, the compiler updation. Automatic magic means nothing magical. Everything is people did mistake and they learned that, array, we did a mistake, it is not happening this one. So they made some changes in the compiler. They added automatic keyword to that. So with the automatic keyword now, this task, that earlier problem we could able to overcome. So that is what this automatic task. Tasks are normally static in nature. If you see this this one, in nature they are static. All declared items are statically allocated, and they are shared across all users of tasks executing concurrently, so that the space is shared across all. Therefore, if task is called concurrently, that is parallelly, from two places in the code, these tasks calls will operate on the same variable because they share it across all tasks because it's static in nature. It is highly likely that the results of such an operation will be incorrect. To avoid this problem, keyword automatic is added in front of the task keyword to make the task re-entrant. Such tasks are called automatic tasks. So guys, tasks, generally we speak about these tasks. These tasks are static in nature. So to overcome that problem, we added this this automatic keyword. This keyword is added just before the task keyword. So that is one thing that we have to understand. All items declared inside automatic tasks are allocated dynamically for each invocation. This is what happening just because of adding this task keyword just before the task. Just before the task keyword, if you add that automatic, then what is happening? Allocated dynamically for each. Each task call operates in an independent space. Does the task calls operate on independent copies of the task variables? This results in the correct operation. So guys, so that is important. The same applies to functions as well. The same concept. Again, need not to explain this one because I will share this PPT anyway. So let us go to the examples because the same concept here. So other than this function here, we have something called constant function, something called sine function. Kindly go through in case what is constant function, what is sine function. Otherwise, tomorrow I will take up this one. But today we will present with this example of how the usage of the task is. So this is the example here I have taken for this. This, if you see, this is A0, B0. Likewise, everywhere you see A1, B1. And you see here A2, B2. And you see here A3, B3. These are 4 bits. And I have another 4 bits here. Meaning total 8 bits actually. 8 bits addition it is. So we are performing with a 4-bit task. This is one task here. Idea is to accomplish 8-bit addition using 4-bit tasks. That's the idea. So this is one task and this is another task. Task 1 and task 2. So let us see how this task one, actually how we are accomplishing 8-bit addition with the help of a task. That let us understand this code. So if you see the first one here, this very first line, you know this is a port declaration. Port declaration. In the port declaration, what we have here, A and B and sum and carry out, that we have. This is sum and this is your A and this is your B. So this one, second line, third line and fourth line, if you see carefully, type declaration, this portion is called type declaration here. So that's why this directions, if you see A and B, type, and the sizes also mentioned here. This is, if I'm keeping like this, so more than 1 bit. This slash. So likewise, if you see the sum, the type declaration and more than 1 bit it is. But if you see the output, there is no size here, scalar. So it's not required to put here that one slash. Now, if you come to the task portion here, this is from here to where is that task here? End task. And this portion. This portion, line number 6 to 12. What we have done here, task and task 4-bit. This is the name given. This is the name given to that. Task 4-bit is the name. You can give anything. It's a user defined name. The syntax is, as you know, every statement is terminated with a semicolon, except the last one here. If you see the last one. No semicolon. And also, of course, these delimiters will not have semicolon. So these statements here, they have semicolon. So likewise, here also we have semicolon. Task and task name, and then we have semicolon. And these are the local here. I was talking about in the beginning of this today's session, this input keyword, this input keyword, and this output. These are totally different from this. Never ever mix up. This input keyword is talking about the ports. This ports. These are the ports here. Top level if you see. Top level if you see, these are the ports here. But if you see to the task here, this one here, these are not the ports. These are not the ports. Then what they are? These are not the ports. These are not the ports. Then what they are? They are to pass this argument. We are calling them argument here. Let me change the color of this. You see here, this portion here, this one, A, B, 0, sum, seed. All these are actually arguments. Arguments. These arguments, you are passing to the task. You are invoking the task here, this way, the task name, you know, the task here. Task. 4-bit. This task 4-bit is the name used here. Task space task 4-bit is used here. Where you are using another observation is required. Where you are using this task invocation? Inside the always. See inside. This is inside the always. Inside always. Let me clear everything here one more time. So guys, here the point here is this is the task, and here we are trying to understand the input of this. These keywords, input, output, these are totally different from this input, output here. These are ports. And these are not ports. These are used to pass the arguments. These are not ports. These input, outputs are used to pass these arguments here. These arguments we have to pass here. The order is important here. The order here, you see this first one here, this first one, and you must have idea to which one you are going to bind here. This name is totally different. A 3:0. If you see here, your this port, your port has got totally how many bits? 8 bits. If you see to the A has got from 0 to 7. 0 to 7, totally 8 bits. Similarly, B also has got 0 to 7. Now, among these 0 to 7 here, this vector size, bit select and part select. Earlier, we spoke about bit select and part select. Part select means among these 8 bits, some more than 1 bit, if I take, that is part select. If I take only 1 bit, it's a bit select. Now what my idea is to take some sphere bits here. So those sphere bits are lower four bits, 0 to 3. How I take? This is how I take here. You see, just a moment. This portion. You see here, this one. From this total eight bits, your lower four bits you have picked. Similarly, lower four bits from the B. You have picked lower 4 bits from the B you have picked. And this is the 0 you are sending first. First task invocation, you are sending 0 here. 0 you are sending. Now, what needs to be returned here? If you see the sum here, this output is not a primary port. It is in the task, right? It's not a port. It is used to return the argument. How task returns the argument? With the keyword output. How task takes the arguments? With the keyword input. That should be clear there. If you have any queries, you can ask. Now coming to the sum here, carefully what we are doing here is, if you see the variables used here, this is A, purposefully it has been used, A underscore task, B underscore task, C in underscore task, sum underscore, these are local to this task. Now this local variables, them you call variables or identifiers. These variables you want to tie with which variables of your ports that you should take care. My aim is this A should be going and tied with this A underscore task. My aim is to go take this B and tie with this B underscore task. My aim is to pass this zero third one and it should go here to the third one here. This one, this is the one over, second over, then obviously the left one is this third one. And the third one I placed purposefully here. I cannot place this one here in the second. Otherwise, it will mismatch. This zero will go to the B underscore task. And now, very cleverly, what I am doing, this sum underscore task is the output, right? It's a 4-bit, right? If you see the vector size 4, right? It should return and it should come and be associated with this sum port. Sum, if you see the sum is a port here. And that is what I'm cleverly putting. And now this one, if you see, this one, first task invocation, it is generating a carry, right? This carry, intermediate carry. That carry, what I am doing, if you see very carefully here, this carry generated when I invoke the first time, this carry generated, I am capturing in a C int. And C int needs to be declared somewhere. Here, if you see here, this C int. And this C int is declared with a reg. Why it is declared with a reg? Anyone having answer why it is declared with a reg? Why not wire? Anyone having answer?
We should not use wire, sir.
Uh-huh.
We should not use wire inside our task or function.
That is not the exact answer. That is not the exact answer. Any other answer? I appreciate you. You at least dare to answer that. That I appreciate. That you have to speak. Those who are present there. I don't know. I have to go to that Google Meet and have to see the names there. I am in the presentation mode. Anyone there? Hello.
Sir, can you repeat that question again?
Question is this cint declaration here. From here I moved here like this. I came here, and I found that this cint here. This cint is declared here with a reg. My question is why with reg? Why not with wire?
So, because it is declared in between big always block.
Yes, that's the answer. That is the answer. Now, guys, everyone pay attention. We said that wire cannot be declared inside the task. Here, this is the task, right? This is the task. In this portion, my question is not here related to this. It is not the question. Question is this C int here. If you see here, it is out. This is declared here. Not it is. It is out of the scope. Some person answered that inside that. Can someone unmute? Somebody unmuted. Okay, thank you. So now inside the task, if question would have been, then wire we cannot use here inside the task. So that is possibly maybe correct answer. But the point here is. This cint is declared with a reg, meaning what actually this cint is getting assigned within the always. You know, earlier we spoke several times within the always, if something is getting assigned, that is LHS, left hand side. So the something that gets assignment will be there on the LHS side, and something that drives will be there on the RHS right hand side. So this LHS LHS side should be variable. It should be variable. It should be variable data type. Variable data type. Among variable data type, most frequently used is the reg for assignments. For assignments. Is that clear to everyone? The person, especially somebody answered why. And other the, apart from that person to everyone, is that clear?
Yes, sir.
So guys, remember here the scene, if you do with a wire or if you don't declare at all, I mean, you did not use reg and you did not use wire also, and you did not scene, actually you did not declare scene, then what happens? Anyone answers? If you did not declare with the scene, what happens? Can anyone? Scene is not declared. Let us say scene is not declared. Then what happens?
So implicitly it is treated as a wire variable. Wire data type.
That's great. That's good. So guys, there, everyone, implicitly, if you don't declare a variable or identifier, frequent I am calling anything that you use, variable or identifier, never ever confuse my usage of variable with the variable data type. I'm just saying this A, B, some C naught, like that, them variable I'm using. Otherwise, you can call them identifiers also. If you don't use, if you don't declare with the wire or reg, or if you don't declare at all, suppose say you use it the scene, but you see it in nowhere is seen. Such undeclared identifiers are implicitly treated by the compiler as scalar type wires. Since it is treated implicitly by the compiler scalar type wire, it is going to throw error. Because inside the always statement, when something is getting assigned, it must belong to variable data type. Among variable data type, reg most frequently used. So it is actually not declared, means it is implicitly wire. So that is also wrong. So that's why explicitly we have to declare this usage, cint as a reg. So that is the explanation about the first one. Now coming to the second task here, the left out bits here. If you see, just a moment, let us hear this. The left out, we used four here. This lower four bits are over here. That upper four bits here used. Now in the upper four bits, if you see here, the C int is going as input here. Task two. This is the task two. So that's why you have used this C int here. C int. Now very cleverly this sum returns something that is placed here, and this CO underscore task will return actual carry out that is placed here. So guys, there, is that clear? This explanation, this from here to here, is that clear everything?
Yes, sir.
So kindly simulate this in your simulator. I will share today itself for this slide. So this has got test bench also. You kindly simulate, try what is really happening, try to understand this one. Now move on to this very quickly. I think we are running out of the time. So we have to wrap this function also. If you see the function usage, the same example taken here, the same example, this is the same, 8-bit adder. You see the function here, this is the function, just a moment, let me clear this one. This here to here. This is our function. Function and the function size here, what is that we have to observe is the size we have to observe. Size. We have this is the 5-bit. 5-bit is the size. 5-bit is the size. Why 5-bit is taken? Because when this adds here, this 4-bit, 4 plus 4, we may end up with a 4 sum and one carry. So in order to handle this 5-bit strength, so we declared here this strength here, the size of the function as a 5. That's how we have to plan. Those who are learning especially, for them I'm telling, and those who are familiar already, not required for them, the size is important here, guys. Here, this is the size of the function. This is very, very important. Because what it has to return, this function is returning with the name, function name itself. You see the function here, function 4-bit. This function 4-bit. You see the function 4-bit, name of the function. Name of the function is used here to return it. Here you see, return. Whereas in the task here, if you see, the task here, task is not having any size here. Task is not having any size. Is there any size here? Meaning size is not, no size. And it has got only name. And is there name returning here? Is there anywhere name returning? Means a name not returning anything. What is returning then? This output keyword is returning. This output keyword is returning. This output keyword is helping to return these arguments here. These are. So guys, pay attention here very carefully. Here this is the function. Function is a keyword. Here the task is a keyword. Here the task is a keyword. And this is the task name. Similarly, here is a function, is a keyword. And after that is the size. And then function name. Function name could be anything. It is not necessary that you have to use function 4-bit only. You can use anything here. BBC. You can use BBC. Now you use here instead of 4-bit, you use BBC. That's all. But the size is important. The size you can is important. What is the size? That is important. Now arguments, how it is taking here? Function C. How you are calling function? You are calling the function, invoking the function with the name. So BBC. Is the name, new name. So BBC, now the arguments you are passing A, B, and carry in. That is first carry 0. Here this is the first carry. This is 0 we are passing. So that is here you are doing. First argument, second argument, and third argument. So this will go here. And according to the order, again, the order is important, friends, guys there. Order is important. You cannot put a 0. If you put 0, this 0 is tied with the, this one, A underscore function here. This underscore function is used, you can use anything. Here you can use KKK underscore B. And you can use here also something C, something whatever. This is the local, these names are local to this function. Local to this function. So, the point here I'm trying to make here is how arguments are passed. These are the only input arguments. Only input arguments. Now this function returns with the name here, this function 4-bit you use to know. The values, whatever it is accomplishing, are stored in the name of the function. And the name of the function is capable of holding the 5-bit size. And it returns here that those 5-bits. And those 5-bits will go here. And accordingly, this will be assigned. You see here carefully, if you observe this, I concatenated the C int and sum lower 4-bits. I concatenated. The 5-bits that come, I said, no, the sum 4-bits carry 1. So these 4-bits, lower 4-bits are assigned to this sum. And the carry is assigned to C int. That's the idea. That's why I use the concatenation operator. I use the concatenation operator. Is that clear to everyone there?
Yes, sir.
So now if you see the second instantiation here, what I'm doing is upper 4-bits. Now in the figure, if you see this upper four, this upper four along with that, this C in also. The C in already I captured it, no, here in the C int. This C int captured is used here, C int, and the upper 4-bits here. All of them I am passing here to this function. in the order wise, this is the first, no, this first will go to the first identifier here, first variable of the function, local, this a underscore function is local to this function only. So the first one, according to the position, they will be associated. Remember, according to the position. And this b is the second, no, the second identifier. The c int is the third identifier, no. So this, the third identifier is this here. Now this first identifier here, second identifier here, third identifier here, all of them been added here with the help of this plus sign, and the result is stored in the function name itself. Function name itself. Now this function name, once it is done, it returns here the value. Here. Now this value is assigned to this left hand side. So that's why this you have to take care this sum. Some, if someone forgetting here reg, suppose a reg declaration, they're forgetting. Now it simulator will throw error because this output sum you have declared for you, it seems that that is correct. But where you are assigning to the sum, where being in assign, no, being always statement you are assigning to the sum. Whatever you assign being in always, that is LHS side, that is left hand side, it should belong to variable data type. That's why you have to declare it as a reg again. So that care you have to take. If you don't take care that, then it will throw error. You cannot simulate this one. So guys, that's about the function usage. Several you can work from home. MUX 4:1 or 4:1 using task and function